So, yeah, now we are going to talk about the computational algorithm selection, and in particular we will talk about a technique called nested cross-validation. In the next video I will show you also some code examples for that. So yeah, back to the computational and empirical methods. So just a recap, just setting up the stage for explaining nested cross-validation, just to recap some aspects we talked about earlier. So one method we talked about for model selection was the three-way holdout method. So here's just a recap using a slightly different figure. So what we do is we split our original data set into a training set and a test set, and then we split the training set further into a smaller training set and a validation set. So we use the training set then together with a machine learning algorithm and a specific hyperparameter set and fit it. So we get a model out of it if we fit the machine learning algorithm or the model with a particular hyperparameter setting. And then we do that for different hyperparameter settings and we keep the performances. So we may end up, let's say, with 10 different models, 10 different models and performances, and we select the one with the highest performance. And again, this is measured on the validation set. And when we select the best one, we can then fit it to the combined training set, or we can just leave it as is and just consider it fit to the smaller training set and evaluate its final performance on the test set. So why do we have an independent test set here? It's because when we do this procedure here, we change the hyperparameters and we evaluate many different models, so there can be some sort of selection bias if we select the best performing one based on this one validation set. So in order to then get the generalization performance estimate that is less biased, we would then still use our independent test set. Okay, so here's another recap. I made this figure some time ago and never really used it anywhere, so I'm just recycling this figure here I found on my computer. So it's just, I think, a useful way to recap the model selection case. So first, what we have here is the scenario where we just evaluate a model. So so we have a model that is fit to the training set and then evaluated on the test set, but we have no model tuning. So in this case, if we don't do any model tuning, just using a single training set and a test set is absolutely fine. So that's a good approach. There's nothing wrong with this. For the second case, what we have here, that would be a case where we have multiple models. We have a training set and a test set, and we train all the models here, let's say with different hyperparameter settings, on the same training set, and then we evaluate all the models on the same test set and we use the best performing one. This is actually not a good approach because we shouldn't use the test set multiple times. The test set should only be used once. In step three, this would be, if I look at it, this would be the three-way holdout method that we talked about just one slide ago. So we have again multiple models fit to the training set. They have all different hyperparameter settings. So the algorithm was run with multiple hyperparameter settings, so we get different models. And we use the validation set to select the best performing model, which we then evaluate on the test set. So this is also a good approach. That is what we talked about last time. So we avoid the selection bias, or we avoid biasing the performance estimate on the test set by using this validation set to rank the models. A better way would be k-fold cross-validation, which we talked about last week. So this would be even better than the step three, three-way holdout method. So I would say go with method four instead of three, especially if you don't have a very large data set. For deep learning, it's totally fine to use three because we usually have larger data sets, and in deep learning there's also the added complication that we have to kind of sometimes babysit the models and see whether they converge when we fit them. Okay, so but again, to recap k-fold cross-validation, so we now, instead of creating a validation set, we have the different rounds in k-fold cross-validation, where in each round we fit the model to the training set and then evaluate it on the validation set. And we do that with different hyperparameter settings. So if we have four hyperparameter settings, we get four performance estimates. from that, and then we select the best performing hyperparameter setting based on the k-fold cross-validation performance, and then evaluate that model after fitting it on the combined on the whole training set. Then we evaluate it on the test set. So this was the k-fold cross-validation that we talked about last week. Now we will go a step further. So talking about this, this is really for selecting hyperparameters. So now the next task would be selecting algorithms. You can think of it as another loop. So you can think of this as hyperparameter tuning for, oops, I can't really write down here because there's my color bar for the pen, hyperparameter tuning for given, let me write this here, hyperparameter tuning for a given algorithm. So that's what we do here. Now we want to take a further step and we want to compare different algorithms. So this could be, for example, for KNN. But now let's say we want to compare KNN to decision trees, to gradient boosting, to random forests, and so forth. So we want to compare different algorithms, and each algorithm will also include this hyperparameter tuning because we really want to select the best model from each algorithm and then compare them to each other. So what we do is we add another loop to the cross-validation procedure, which is why it's called nested cross-validation. So we have an outer loop, and the purpose here is it serves the same purpose as doing the train and the test split. So the outer loop is really like for getting the performance of a model, whereas the inner loop is more like for the hyperparameter tuning. So we have an inner loop that is like k-fold cross-validation for tuning. So here it's not for finding the best model or hyperparameter setting, and then the outer one is for evaluating that model or say a hyperparameter setting. So there are now two, it's a two-step procedure in essence. Yeah, because it is a two-step procedure, it's a little bit more complicated than our regular k-fold cross-validation. In fact, you can think of it as two k-fold cross-validations nested within each other. Okay, let's try to go through this illustration in a way that is the least confusing, starting at the top with our original data set. So we have our original data set. Assume we also for later have another independent set for testing, but this is our main training set. So what we do is we have, similar to k-fold cross-validation, a loop that we have like a five-fold loop, like in a five-fold cross-validation. And in each round here, round 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, we split the data set into training folds and a test fold. So this is the, for this case, the combined training folds for the first iteration and then the test fold. So we do that 5 times. But now, in contrast to k-fold cross-validation, so in k-fold cross-validation, what we would do is we would fit the model on the training folds and evaluate it on the test folds. Here we don't do that, we go one step further. So we take a training fold, so here, let's consider this case here at the bottom. It's easier because I attached something to the bottom of this one. So this is again our training fold. And here, what we now do is we do another k-fold cross-validation. So instead of fitting the model on this one and evaluating in the test fold, we have now a two-fold k-fold cross-validation. So in this case, many people do a 2 times 2 CV nested cross-validation, five times two nested cross-validation. But yeah, I experimented with that. There's no reason really to do the 5 by 2. It can also be 5 by 5 or 5 by 10. So based on my experiments and experiments by a student of mine, Richard Yang, we didn't find any substantial advantage of having more accurate estimates when doing a 5x2 procedure versus 5x5 or 5x10 or 2x5 and so forth. So in different data sets, it's different. So it was not like as clear as in Ron Kohavi's paper, where tenfold cross-validation on most datasets was better than fivefold or 20-fold. We didn't find a trend like that. But in any case, so let's consider the 5x2 procedure. So now we have split the training fold further. So we have a smaller training fold and a validation fold here. So here, this is really like the inner loop is really the one that is most similar to k-fold cross-validation for model selection. So here, I also should say, let's say we talk about decision trees. We apply a decision tree algorithm to this whole nested cross-validation procedure, and then in the inner loop, in the two-fold procedure, we do the hyperparameter tuning. So we would evaluate, for example, the max depth of the decision tree, the criterion like entropy or Gini, and so forth. So in each one here, we would tune the hyperparameters. So we would, for example, find based on this inner fold that a max depth of 2 and entropy would be best. So we know that then, and then we would fit the model with these settings. So we would evaluate many different hyperparameter settings, like in k-fold cross-validation, and then for the best one, we would fit the model on the training fold then with the best settings, and then evaluate it on the test fold. So now we have done that for this last round here. We found that 2, max depth of 2 and entropy is best, and we have the performance of that for the test fold. Let's say it's 80% on the test fold. Okay, next then we would do that again. Now let's say we do that on this case here. We can just take this one. It's just a little bit harder to imagine it because we have the training folds here on both sides. So when we combine them, this would be our training set. So here we would again split that into a smaller training fold and validation fold, and then do hyperparameter tuning. And based on the hyperparameter tuning, we also would find the best settings. It can be that it's also the same, that it's consistent, it's max depth of 2 and entropy, but in practice it may be something different. It could also be, let's say, max depth of 3 and now it could be Gini. And then we would get the performance of that one on this test fold. So we do that then 5 times. We hope, if we have a stable model, that all of these suggest the same best hyperparameter settings, and we evaluate them on a test fold, but that does not have to be true. And that's why it's more like an algorithm selection procedure, the nested cross-validation. So here we finish this then. So we do this for the 5 iterations, and we will get 5 performance estimates. So 5 performance estimates, and they can be from different models. So we would then average those. So we would, in this case, let's call them from I equals 1 to t for t test folds, and then we would average, for example, the accuracies. And we do this then for the decision tree. So we have a accuracy of the decision tree algorithm on that data set of, let's say, it's averaged 83% or something like that. So we have evaluated now the decision tree algorithm on that data set. Now, then after doing that, we can do the same thing for different algorithms. We can, for example, use KNN or gradient boosting or random forests and repeat the procedure. And then for each of them, we get, let's say, an accuracy, let's say 84. Let's do something that's maybe more substantially different, let's say 80%. So it tells us that if we would use an algorithm like KNN and would tune it to a given data set and things like that, we would expect that it gets roughly that performance. So after we selected our algorithms. So if we compare, let's say, decision tree and KNN to each other, so based on these, just by comparing which one has the higher accuracy, we can then pick this algorithm. Let's say we end up picking the decision tree algorithm as the best algorithm for this data set. Then we still don't have a model if we need a model for our application. If we wanted to get a model, we can take a look at the different hyperparameter settings across these five folds, select the one that that had either the highest test performance here on the test fold, or if we have ties, select the one setting that was most often selected, and then fit a model on the whole data set with this setting and evaluate it on the test set to get a independent performance estimate on the independent test set, estimate of the generalization performance. But yeah, in a nutshell, this is how the nested cross-validation procedure works. Yeah, so just a recap, the outer loop here. So we use the average performance as generalization performance. This should be one point. Another point is that we can also use that outer loop to check for model stability. By that, I mean we can look at what the variance is of these estimates, and also we can see how different the different settings are. So if there's a large variance, it also is something that may concern us. So if we consider the case where we have the archive sanity preserver server, we don't want to choose an algorithm here that is very unstable, that has sometimes a good performance on some cases here really bad performance, because then it's really like some users have a really great experience, some users have a very poor experience. So it would be better, even though maybe on average the performance is lower, to pick an algorithm where the settings here vary a little bit less and where the performance estimates are a little bit more stable. Okay, so and then after we've done that, we can then fit the model on the whole data set and get it ready for deployment. All right, so the next video then, the last video for this lecture. Like promised, this will be a little bit of a shorter lecture week because of Thanksgiving. In the next video, I will also show you how we can do the nested cross-validation in code.